Good afternoon. We'll start today's grand round, which is basically by the Department of Pulmonary Critical Care and Sleep Medicine, which is on sarcoid. I think sarcoid is an important disease to discuss because it's multisystem and therefore can present to any specialty. The other important thing is sarcoid was considered uncommon in our country. When I was a resident in PGI and we used to do transbronchial lung biopsies, the head of the Department of Pathology there, Dr. Banerjee, would always say that sarcoidosis doesn't exist in our country, and all TB LBs which had a granuloma were reported as tuberculosis, and sarcoidosis was not even considered. We've come a long way from there, but it is a multisystem disorder, commonly presents with bilateral hyaluronic adenopathy, pulmonary infiltrates, ocular and skin lesions, and like I said, it can involve any organ of the body. There's a whole milestone as far as sarcoid is concerned from 1869. When Hutchinson first described skin lesions, all the way up to 2002, when small fiber neuropathy is also being described as a part of sarcoidosis. However, we have no single diagnostic test. The ATS definition actually is more of a diagnosis of exclusion. A compatible clinical radiological findings, histological evidence of non-necrotizing granulomas, and to rule out other granulomatous disorders. Therefore, it is a systemic disorder, which is basically a diagnosis which is ruled out. It's a multiple pathway disease, and many clinicians call it a chameleon, that it's very difficult to diagnose. And I'll just highlight a few things before we go to the grand round as such. So these are some skin lesions that we've had in our patients, and these are lesions over a scar. This is a lady who's a lawyer, again has presented with these skin lesions. Initial diagnosis was not that of sarcoid. These are erythema nodosum. One of them is our staff nurse in C2 ward. Again, unless you look for it, you will miss this. Skin lesions in another wife of a staff patient with these scaly lesions, all of these are part of sarcoid. And if you don't examine the patient properly, especially the nape of the neck, you may miss these lesions, which again on biopsy would suggest sarcoid. Eye involvement is also important. You have posterior segment involvement, which is also very, very important. And cardiac sarcoid, again, a very important issue which gets missed. This patient is a 60-year-old male who came with complete heart block, admitted in cardiology with a diagnosis of sclerodegenerative heart disease, and was thought to, sarcoidosis wasn't even considered. But a pulmonary medicine consultation was sent because the chest x-ray showed a lot of reticular markings and they felt the x-ray is not looking good. The CT shows classical features which suggest sarcoid. The reason I'm just trying to say that is that sarcoidosis is something which can present to any clinician, and unless you have a high index of suspicion, you will tend to miss that. Even the radiological presentation can be very, very varied, and these are some of the various radiological pictures of sarcoid. You can have a mass-like lesion. This patient has a pleural effusion. Actually, this lady had a massive pleural effusion, had a thoracoscopy. Thoracoscopy showed a granuloma. Continued ATT was given treatment for MDR. But if you look at the lung picture, it's very classical for sarcoid. Then you can have these nodular shadows, which can happen and make the diagnosis more difficult. This is another gentleman who came from orthopedics. Had involvement of his right knee as far as arthritis was concerned. Synovial fluid biopsy actually showed granulomas, was being treated for tuberculosis, subsequently started having shortness of breath and cough, was evaluated in pulmonary medicine and had these sort of alveolar shadows which are classical of sarcoid. TBLB here showed sarcoid, collapse-like lesion and ground glass lesion. So even for radiology, sometime can be an issue as far as diagnosis is concerned. So like I said, a large number of systemic manifestation, almost any organ can be involved, and you may have a varied presentation, and that's why suspecting sarcoid becomes very, very important. We've had patients who've had recurrent Bell's palsy and sarcoidosis was not considered, whereas I would suggest that if you are having recurrent Bell's palsy, do keep a sarcoidosis in mind. And then it becomes a huge challenge as far as tuberculosis are in our country is concerned, because both these diseases are granulomatous disorders, and that is why it becomes challenging. And sometimes they can coexist, and that's why some people argue that they're two sides of the same coin, and a term sarcotuberculosis has also been used. Just to highlight that, this is a patient who I saw many years ago, presented in our OPD with fever and swelling over the right side of the chest. He had a fluctuate lump which was present on the lateral chest wall. I saw him in the OPD, I put in a needle there, got frank pus, AFB was positive, started on ATT, and the lump disappeared. This was his CT at that point in time. You can see this soft tissue shadow, which is the abscess. This is the osteomyelitis. Retrospectively, whenever I've looked at this CT, I felt that there was a little bit of nodularity and some degree of ground glassing, but that was subsequent. He had a subcranial node also, and he was started on ATT. He is basically used to be a bank manager in Bihar. He said he couldn't get any leave, so he came actually after 1 year and continued ATT, had a fresh CT done, told that the disease had deteriorated, and was told to have MDR tuberculosis. The chest lump had disappeared. He had dry cough and only dyspnea on exertion. This is a subsequent CT scan, which shows these extensive nodular shadows in the areas that we had looked at a year ago. Again, a transbronchial lung biopsy was done, and this patient now has sarcoidosis. So he started off with tuberculosis, given ATT, and then subsequently developed these features. He's still on follow-up. He's gone on to develop fibrosarcoidosis. Extensive fibrosis hasn't responded that well. But the point that we're trying to make here is the sarcoidosis becomes more and more difficult to really diagnose in a country like India. And that is what we had highlighted in this article, that there are challenges in diagnosing sarcoid in a tuberculosis endemic country. And that is why you need to have a very high index of suspicion when you're looking at the diagnosis of sarcoid. I think that is what this grand round is all about, the challenges in diagnosing sarcoid and why it's important. I'll stop here and ask Dr. Anant Mohan to talk about the epidemiology of the disease. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And to continue, we'll start off with, as we do for every disease, starting off with the burden of disease, the epidemiology. And here we are talking about sarcoidosis. So as already has been discussed, it is a systemic granulomatous disorder of largely an unknown etiology. Systemic means usually is supposed to be involving at least two or more organs, or some kind of a systemic phenomenon has to be demonstrated. Granuloma in the affected organ also has to be demonstrated as part of the diagnostic criteria. And most of the times, other causes of granulomatous inflammation have to be ruled out. So as already mentioned, it is a diagnosis of exclusion in several ways than one. As far as the prevalence is concerned, the incidence is concerned, there is a considerable disparity because different populations have different kind of incidence and prevalence. In India, of course, the treatment and diagnosis both remain a challenge because, as already mentioned, the high prevalence of TB, the increased chances of sarcoidosis, patients getting misdiagnosed and treated with tuberculosis, thereby losing precious time. Still, there is a reduced awareness among the physicians, although probably the situation is much better as compared to 10, 15 years ago. Awareness is better, but still, if we go somewhere to the semi-rural, rural areas, or down the second or third level of care, probably still sarcoidosis remains missed. And at that point of time, and in those areas like rural facilities, there is definitely lack of advanced diagnostic modalities, and simply by X-ray, one really cannot make a diagnosis of sarcoidosis with any conclusive evidence. The global burden also varies from region to region, and by and large, the highest prevalence has been noted in the Scandinavian countries, where it is as high as up to 28 per lakh population. Worldwide, females seem to be affected more than males. This is the general evidence. It is relatively a disorder relatively of a younger population, with more than two-thirds of patients being less than 40 years of age. And of course, there are specific clinical features which we'll see subsequently. For example, presentation with predominant skin manifestations like erythema nodosum may be more common in some areas like Europe and Japan as compared to Indian patients. But of course, there may be a problem that it may be missed in the Indian subcontinent also because of the skin color, etc., and difficult to discern. So if we just see over here, this is how the global burden is. The number of cases are highest in the orange one. So we can see this is the incidence, and below is the prevalence. So the incidence is highest in the Scandinavian areas, and then followed by the North Americas and the Europe, and also in the Australian continent. And if we look at the prevalence per lakh population, again, the same pattern is there. It is most prevalent in the Scandinavian areas, the Northern Europe, other parts of Europe, parts of North America, and even in India, actually, the prevalence is high because although the incidence per lakh population may be relatively low, but because of the magnitude of the population and sarcoidosis not really being a disease which has a high mortality, the patients are indolent and they have a good lifespan. So that is why the overall burden of disease in absolute numbers is higher in India. Here we can just see again comparison between a few distinct cohorts like the Japanese, Chinese, and the Indian cohorts. if you look at the kind of clinical feature differences, of course, the clinical features will be discussed in some time. But we know that sarcoid is classified by X-rays as stage 0, 1, 2, 3, or 4. And in this Japanese cohort, you can see most of the patients are of the stage 1. In the Chinese cohort, it is the stage 2, which seems to be more prevalent. And in India, stage 1 and stage 2 both are pretty high prevalent, and both of them seem to be constituting almost all the sarcoid patients. And if the other manifestations we look at, cutaneous, ocular, these are the lymphatic, etc. So here again, we see ocular manifestations in many series form the kind of one of the commonest one in the Japanese. Ocular are very common, uveitis, episcleritis, iritis, and here they are pretty well spaced out. In our country, in the Indian cohorts, as we can see over here, the hepatosplenic is something which is significant, and this is something kind of unique. So liver and spleen involvement is something which is more commonly seen in some Indian cohorts, although again, this is not seen in all cohorts, but this is by and large the overall. And then of course, cutaneous, ocular, and lymphatics are following close behind, almost equal in incidence. And here again, if we compare, this is one of the studies which compared the clinical features and the radiological features also of different cohorts, that is the white predominant, the black Afro-Americans, and the Asian predominant cohorts, and pretty large numbers, as you can see. Again, across the board, the relative age is somewhere around 40. Most of the time, there is a female preponderance over here. And I won't focus too much upon all the details, but again, as you can see, in the Asian cohort, it is the eye involvement is pretty common that we had just seen, followed by cutaneous, and lymph nodal involvement is pretty common. And in over here, you can see liver involvement is there, ENT involvement is also there, which is something unique which other cohorts do not really have in so much high prevalence. What do we have from India? Again, we do have several studies available from India from various areas. And again, if we just summarize them, we can see that this present study means it is a study from Lucknow actually. So if again we see the most of the things are, one thing is constitutional symptoms are pretty common in our Indian setup. Arthralgia, malaise, and the fevers are quite common. Eye involvement, lymph node involvement forms the bulk. Liver involvement is also pretty common. So these are some things that we find more as in Indian population as compared to the Western population as well. And if we compare Indian versus the others here, this we see again more higher chances of being at a younger age group, higher chances of having constitutional symptoms like fever, myalgia, lethargy, etc. And over here, the peripheral lymphadenopathy is equal, but here, yeah, higher chances or actually equal chances of getting hepatomegaly, but slightly higher chances of splenomegaly as compared to the other Western studies. These are the ones in the Western studies here. Two other things that we have important in sarcoidosis. One is the Montauk test that we often use to kind of exclude. And most of the time we get a negative Montauk. Here also we have seen a negative Montauk test is there, which is pretty specific for sarcoidosis. Here also in Western studies, Montauk is mostly negative, but it is much more in our population. So these were just a couple of differences I wanted to highlight between the sarcoid profile of India as well as the Western countries. Just one slide on one study that we have very recently published. The rest will be covered by Saurabh later. Again, the clinical profile of around 320 odd patients. Age group is the same as we had talked about. Equal preponderance of males and females. Again, smoking was there in only 10%. So somehow sarcoidosis has a negative association with smoking. This is one of the very few respiratory diseases which have a negative association with smoking in some way, which has been found. Obesity was there, comorbid illnesses, and of course, one third of them had history of ATT intake in the past because of misdiagnosis. Again, I think this will be covered later. In this particular group, extrapulmonary and isolated pulmonary sarcoid were almost equal, and here you can see what were the sites which were commonly involved. Lastly, what exactly causes sarcoidosis? So actually, we don't really know the cause. It is probably a complex interplay between genetic factors, environmental factors, and autoimmune factors. So that is still a subject of extensive research, and kind of there are some strong theories and some not very strong theories about this. Among the environmental causes, the most commonly which can involve the lungs are exposures to airborne antigens in the rural setting, wood burning stoves, tree pollen, etc. several other particles which may be inorganic, insecticides, moldy environments, etc. Some occupations like metal working or firefighting. Interestingly, if you remember the World Trade Center disaster which happened, it was found that sarcoidosis was diagnosed in several of the firefighting people on a long-term follow-up in those in that whole group. So probably there was some kind of connection there. Then we have a lot of infectious agents which have been postulated but never proven. That includes even mycobacteria and others. Mycobacterial tuberculosis infection, in fact, the protein of M. tuberculosis, that is the MCATG protein, has been found in a significant proportion of sarcoid tissue. But a cause-effect relationship so far probably is difficult to establish. And then there are genetic factors, and especially a class 1 HLA-B8 antigen has been found to have a strong predisposition. Even some class 2 antigens and some other genetic factors have been found to be associated with susceptibility to sarcoidosis. And this just brings it all together. This is the last slide, where several genetic factors, infective factors, socioeconomic factors, and environmental factors all come together. They have a complex interplay and interconnectivity, and all of them probably in different ways and different populations have some kind of a propensity of development of sarcoidosis. And this includes certain occupations, even in, and the genetics will be the gender. We have already talked about the racial distinctions, class 1A and the B8 type of HLA antigens. There may be some seasonal variations. There are some metal infections, for example, metal inhalation. For example, berylliosis is very, very closely kind of clinically simulating sarcoidosis, maybe somewhat different, difficult to differentiate. And then, of course, the role of mycobacteria has already been talked about. Lastly, even sarcoid has recurred and occurred in organ donation post-transplants, that is in cardiac and others, even after bone marrow, sarcoidosis has occurred. So with all these, I think basically the epidemiology we have already talked about, the kind of interplay between all these factors plays a role, but still we don't know what is exactly the cause of sarcoidosis. I think now I'll skip this kind of complicated slide. This is the same thing which we have already talked about. I'll ask Dr. Saurabh now to kind of describe the clinical presentation.
So good afternoon. So we'll in brief discuss about the clinical manifestations of sarcoidosis. So as we have seen that it is a multisystem disorder, and in more than 90% of cases, pulmonary involvement is there. Pulmonary involvement means lung as well as the mediastinal lymphadenopathy. So the presentation of sarcoidosis many times is asymptomatic, although it can be acute sarcoidosis, subacute, or a chronic variety of sarcoidosis. There is almost 50% of patients do have constitutional symptoms in form of fever, fatigue, malaise, or weight loss, and a significant proportion has extrapulmonary manifestations. So the common symptoms include cough, dyspnea, ill-defined chest pain. The common lymph nodal stations, which are very important in sarcoidopathy, bilateral hilar lymphadenopathy. But it is also important to know that we rarely see that we do not have a hilar node or a unilateral hilar nodes. If you see these features, then you think that there may be an alternate diagnosis rather than sarcoidosis being the primary diagnosis. Parenchymal involvement also occurs in sarcoidosis in the form of ILD, which predominantly has nodular involvement. It can have endobronchial disease, fibrocystic disease, bronchiectasis, mycetoma. A pleural disease is uncommon in sarcoidosis, and pulmonary hypertension, which is class 5, can also occur in patients with sarcoidosis. So this was a case series of 11 patients with pleural effusion, which was presented from our department recently. So in this group, all patients had a lymphocyte-rich exudative pleural effusion, and diagnosis of sarcoidosis was made, and all effusions improved with steroid therapy. So this is one representative case. This patient had multiple large mediastinal lymph node and unilateral pleural effusion, which was lymphocyte-rich. And on cervical lymph node biopsy, there was a diagnosis of sarcoidosis made. So all these patients improved with sarcoidosis steroid treatment. So this is important to know that pleural involvement is rare, but it does occur, and you need to look for it even if you think of tuberculosis as the primary diagnosis in pleural effusion. So on clinical examination in these patients, they may have wheeze sometimes as well as crackles, but crackles are extremely uncommon. Clubbing is also rare, and in advanced stages, they may have hypoxemia. This was a large series of around 327 patients of sarcoidosis from our department, in which almost 51% had isolated pulmonary sarcoidosis and 49% had extrapulmonary involvement. Among the extrapulmonary involvement, extrathoracic lymph node, eye and skin were the most common sites of involvement. If you look at the symptoms, almost 96% of patients in this series were symptomatic. So we know that a significant proportion, nearly 30 to 40% of larger sarcoidosis series have shown them asymptomatic, although we had majority of the patients who presented with some or the other symptom and diagnosis sarcoidosis. The common symptoms were respiratory, like cough, shortness of breath, and fatigue. Fatigue is a very important and a symptom which has importance in the management of sarcoid, because this tend to persist even after you have treated sarcoid. So fatigue is one symptom which requires a lot of emphasis while treatment of sarcoidosis being given. So the lab parameters in R, we had a very small proportion of patients who had hypercalcemia, but ACE levels were high in nearly 58% of individuals. Also, the Montu test or the tuberculin test, which is thought to be negative in all sarcoid, R series had almost 10% patients who had Montux test reactive, but they were diagnosed as sarcoidosis based on other investigations. So now go to the other systems, because I'll not be detailing about other systems. So another important system which is there is the neurosarcoid, which is also occurring in 5 to 40% of patients, and it can involve CNS as well as the peripheral nervous system. So CNS involvement is much more common than peripheral. We tend to see a lot of neurosarcoidosis these days because it is important to have a suspicion of neurosarcoidosis, because they present with the usual presentation, cranial nerve palsies, myelitis, peripheral neuropathies. So unless you think of the sarcoidosis as diagnosis, you'll miss it. We tend to perform a lot of lung biopsies from normal lungs in patients with suspected neurosarcoid, and we find granulomas in normal lung appearance as well. The other system involvement include GI involvement, which has transaminitis or a chronic liver disease or bowel granulomas, genitourinary tract involvement like hypercalcemia, which can lead to acute renal failure, interstitial nephritis. We have seen cases of urinary bladder granuloma as well. And sarcoid can also lead to arthropathy. So these are some uncommon or less commonly seen manifestations. But the important thing here remains that sarcoidosis can involve any organ system, and if you do not have a suspicion of sarcoidosis, you will not diagnose it. This was one case series from our department where we had a comparison of the clinical profile of sarcoidosis versus mediastinal tuberculosis. And we found that compared to mediastinal TB, patients with sarcoidosis had a longer duration of symptoms. They tended to be younger and had higher BMI. It was also important that patients with sarcoidosis had higher prevalence of diabetes and hypothyroidism. So hypothyroidism is something which we have found, that a lot of patients with sarcoidosis tend to have hypothyroidism as a comorbidity. They had symptoms in form of breathlessness, cough. However, fatigue and anorexia were much more common in TB patients as compared to the sarcoidosis. So how do we differentiate that necrotic lymph nodes were more common in tuberculosis? On endobronchial ultrasound, there was heterogeneous or coagulation necrosis more in TB. So what this case series kind of tell that a comprehensive clinical, radiological and pathological approach may allow to differentiate sarcoid from mediastinal TB, even though they look similar on a primary approach. But you need to have a clinical as well as radiological and pathological differentiation so you can reach a correct diagnosis. So I'll just briefly tell the investigations which are usually done, which include the LFT, KFT, Montux test, serum ACE levels, 24-hour urinary calcium, eye evaluation, very importantly, CT chest, a biopsy from an involvement site, and we need to do some investigations to rule out active TB. For other extrapulmonary, we may need to do Holter, ECHO, NCS, MRI, PET scan, MRI brain. And for lung, we need to do pulmonary function test as well as the 6-minute walk test, which help us in the follow-up of these patients as well. So like sir also told about that, how do we differentiate this problem of TB versus sarcoid? So the important differentiating features which have to be kept in mind is that Montu test, which is much more common in TB as compared to sarcoidosis, symmetry of lymph node involvement, which is more in sarcoidosis, while TB tend to have asymmetric lymph nodes, and multi-station involvement with homogeneous lymph nodes, which is more common in sarcoidosis as compared to tuberculosis. So that's all about the clinical features. And now I'll request sir to continue with the further extrapulmonary manifestations.
Thank you, Saurabh, and I thank the Department of Pulmonary Medicine to give us an opportunity to speak. So it's truly a multi-system disease, and I'll just highlight a couple of things in terms of the cardiac involvement. So a clinically manifest cardiac involvement is generally seen only in 5 to 6% of the patients. But if you look at the autopsy series, the silent involvement may be in 25% of the patients may have cardiac involvement. In fact, with newer imaging tools like MRI and PET scan, the cardiac involvement is in 1 in 4 patients of sarcoidosis. Some of the races like that in Japan have been reported to have higher incidence, higher involvement of cardiac in patients with sarcoidosis, with reports of as much as 50 to 70% involvement. And the clinical feature that depends really on the location, extent, and activity of the disease. However, in several series, and you know, most of the series are very small series, 60 to 100 patient series are there, but up to 1/3 patients may have isolated cardiac sarcoidosis. But again, as highlighted earlier, it really depends how closely you look for other system involvement. But there are series which have reported up to 1/3 of the patients have only cardiac sarcoidosis and not involvement of other systems. So why should you look for cardiac sarcoidosis? Why should you screen for cardiac sarcoidosis? So from the literature, it's quite evident that once cardiac involvement happens, it significantly worsens the morbidity and mortality in patients. Indeed, sudden cardiac death, you know, the very immediately fatal outcome may be one of the first manifestations of the disease. And in some series, as accounted for 65% of the deaths are sudden cardiac death. So that's quite a catastrophic happening to take place for a patient. In the Japanese population, the leading cause of death in patients with sarcoidosis is cardiac deaths, and that's again because of very high prevalence of cardiac involvement in that race. It has also been shown that many studies, the treatment of cardiac sarcoidosis with steroids leads to improvement in LV ejection fraction. That's especially true if you start treatment early, may not happen once there is severe LV dysfunction. So there is an early need to screen, diagnose cardiac sarcoidosis to improve outcomes. So the clinical presentation can be very varied. If there is a very minimal involvement, there are small patch of basal septum involvement, that's the area which typically gets involved to begin with and most commonly involved at the base of the septum. The patient, it may be clinically silent. However, if there is large septal involvement, that's where all the conduction systems are there. So you may present patients with, as Serge showed that case of complete heart block, you may present with to a cardiologist with cardiac EV block and needing a pacemaker. So we have to beware of, you know, such patients, especially young CHBs, you look for sarcoidosis. Thankfully, we now now the awareness for this is there among cardiologists and others. We don't always need the pulmonary medicine to make the diagnosis. We are able to do some of it ourselves. Then if there is more extensive involvement, there may be reentrant tachycardias. And again, one of the thing is VT, and we've had patients coming with VT storm, managed with, pulse steroid, very well managed and controlled with pulse steroid therapies. So that is the other manifestation. And as the extent goes up, there may be loss of myocardium, and you may have all those manifestations along with heart failure because of decreased myocardial contractility. So the presentations can be very different. Most common is AV block, then heart failure, VT, and the dreaded complication of sudden death, maybe in about 15 to 20% of the patients. So when to suspect cardiac sarcoid in a patient who's not known to be sarcoidosis? As I said, unexplained complete heart block in young people, a VT in young in the absence of coronary artery disease, and ischemic and severe LV dysfunction, again, in the absence of other known causes. And it's been seen that up to 6% of the patients going for cardiac transplant had cardiac sarcoidosis. So what are the cardiac investigations, the basic cardiac investigation that, and what to look for in these? ECG, look for blocks, look for ventricular ectopy, look for fragmented, that is broad QRS with fragmented QRS segments. ECHO, typically, which is very characteristic but not very sensitive, is a septal thickening. The base of the interventricular septum is thickened. You can have aneurysms. There can be regional wall motion abnormalities, which are not in the coronary or typical coronary artery distribution, but may be varied and multiple. And of course, unexplained dilated cardiomyopathy. MRI has come up as a very important tool in cardiac sarcoidosis, and it's been increasingly used. There are no fixed patterns of involvement, but you have focal and patchy involvements. There is LG uptake in non-ischemic areas, subepicardial and mid-myocardial areas, which can be very much like any myocarditis. The base of septum and lateral wall are more involved. The most commonly involved area, as I said, is the septum, and the involvement at the insertion sites of the papillary muscles may be there. And then the other thing is PET. Again, typically FDG PET is what is recommended, earlier gallium 67. But now in our center, we do gallium dotanoc because, you know, preparing patients for FDG PET is quite challenging. So dotanoc is basically showing inflammation. And the advantage of PET over MRI is that you can look, if you want to look for inflammation, it's much better than an MRI. And you can actually look at the activity of disease by repeating a PET scan. So that's the advantage over MRI. So how do you screen for cardiac sarcoid, and which, as I highlighted, is important to do in every sarcoid patient. Everybody, obviously, for logistic reasons, cannot undergo an MRI, which is could or a PET CT or a PET MRI, which is a gold standard for diagnosis. So, and probably they don't need to, because the prognosis for asymptomatic sarcoids who do not have any of these features is quite good. So you just look for symptoms. This is the one given by the Heart Rhythm Society in 2014 guidelines. You look for symptoms of cardiac symptoms. You look for ECG, any of those findings, bundle branch block, which I discussed, or frequent VPCs or abnormal Q waves in the ECG. Look for those findings in echo. And if any of those three are positive, then you go for cardiac MRI. So that's the normal sequence that is described. We have been doing a study along with Karan and the department. It's a thesis case, and we've thought to expand the screening modality, and we've added a couple of things. There's a near modality called global longitudinal strain, which picks up LV dysfunction much earlier than the LV ejection fraction. So we're doing that. We're doing troponin, which is maybe raised in some of these patients, and we're doing screening for BNP. So we've added these three to see the sense and compare it with the classical HRS system. And any of these five are positive, the patients have gone undergoing cardiac MRI. So using this criteria, I think this is about a month old, where we've analyzed data, intermediary data, and out of the 60 biopsy proven sarcoidosis, you know, the sarcoidosis, cardiac sarcoidosis has two ways to diagnose. Either you do EM biopsy and do a confirmatory diagnosis, which is the confirmatory diagnosis, but it's extremely insensitive. Even if we use a biopsy driven by electrophysiology, where you look for scar and then do a biopsy, still the sensitivity is very low. So most of the diagnosis is probable cardiac sarcoidosis, where you look for where there's a proven sarcoid in non-cardiac tissue, and then you have one of these features. So this has really picked up many patients which would not have been picked up by the conventional HRS definitions, and this is ongoing process. So as you can see, about one in three patients had cardiac sarcoid on screening, and most of them have been confirmed on MRI. So we would compare this with the other non-mortality and see what the ROC is better for this diagnosis as compared to the conventional diagnosis. I know the treatment is going to be discussed, but I would just like to highlight the fact, in the view of sudden cardiac death, which is one of the very dreaded outcomes of these patients, because they're very much prone to VT. The threshold for implanting cardiac defibrillator is much lower in this patient as compared to the conventional patients. Of course, anybody with LV ejection fraction and a sustained VT needs a defibrillator. But in patients with cardiac sarcoidosis, the threshold is lower in terms of even somebody with a normal ejection fraction, more than 35% and syncope, or presence of more than 10% scar on cardiac MRI, or with an indication of permanent pacing probably, and those with inducible ventricular arrhythmia should get an ICD, because you know, the risk for ventricular tachycardia and storm is quite high over there. So I'll just stop over there and ask Sujoy to talk about the cutaneous manifestation.
So we see quite a bit of cutaneous sarcoidosis, and in the beginning, Professor Guleria has shown you wonderful images of cutaneous sarcoidosis that he has encountered in his clinical practice, and so do we. And there are three things that we see. Either it's a skin-only sarcoidosis, which manifests only with skin disease and stays as skin disease. The other is that's the first presentation to a dermatologist, and during a systemic evaluation, we are able to show that there is extracutaneous involvement and therefore are able to refer the patient to various specialists. Or then if there is a suspicion of cutaneous sarcoidosis amongst various specialists, do we get referrals and are able to confirm a diagnosis of cutaneous sarcoidosis. The conventional teaching says that cutaneous sarcoidosis or sarcoidosis of any area is a great masquerader. Over the years, having seen cutaneous sarcoidosis, we have now been able to appreciate certain specific features by which we are able to definitely, on clinical features, able to make a diagnosis of cutaneous sarcoidosis and then evaluate them for systemic evaluation. So the cutaneous involvement occurs in about 11 to 34% of cases, and Anand Mohan's initial epidemiological studies showed this range in various Indian studies also. And in fact, in the study by your department, about 11% of the patients had concomitant cutaneous sarcoidosis. These are a large number of morphological types of cutaneous sarcoidosis that we see, many of which are specific. These are more commonly seen. These are some less commonly seen. And we can have isolated mucosal involvement, especially the oral and the genital mucosal involvement. We can have a sole manifestation of sarcoidosis involving the scalp and the nails. And we can also have sarcoidosis as a reaction to an underlying sarcoidosis, which means the patient either may manifest as an erythema nodosum, which is the commonest, but because of hypercalcemia would also show up calcinosis cutis as a reactionary manifestation. We occasionally see maculopapular eruptions, which is often mistaken as a viral exanthem or a drug reaction, which is actually a reaction to an underlying manifestation of sarcoidosis. And rarely we see erythema multiforme-like lesions. So the head and neck is the commonest site for cutaneous sarcoidosis. And so also the trunk. And Dr. Guleria had emphasized on the nape of the neck and the upper back as a very classic site for cutaneous sarcoidosis. So when we are suspecting, we always look at these two areas to be able to establish the diagnosis of cutaneous sarcoidosis. Upper limb is involved. Lower limb is rarely involved as compared to the other sites. There can be variable morphologies. So it can be either a single non-scaly asymptomatic indolent papule, or it can be a very, very extensive eruptive papular or micropapular sarcoidosis. It can be a plaque form of sarcoidosis, and under such circumstances, we offer differentials because this can be mimicked by other infectious granulomas like cutaneous tuberculosis or leishmaniasis or borderline tuberculoid leprosy. This is mimicked by a B-cell lymphoma. A pseudolymphoma can look just like this, both of the B and the T-cell type. And in fact, cutaneous forms of lupus erythematosus, what we refer to as the tumored forms of lupus erythematosus, exactly mimic sarcoidosis. We can have the annular forms, the nodular forms as we see here. We can have a combination of two morphologies such as the papules and the plaques. It can occur on old scars for many, many years, patient having had glass injuries or traumatic injuries for 20 to 30 years, after which there is reactivation of sarcoidosis in them. It can manifest just as a hypopigmented sarcoidosis. And these patients often visit us because the fear that they may be suffering from a leucoderma, that is vitiligo, or more commonly as leprosy. And therefore, we must be aware of this variant of sarcoidosis to be able to confirm, make a diagnosis. You can have these very disseminated atrophic forms. This is a patient that we saw, and he was being treated for cutaneous T-cell lymphoma of the mycosis fungoides type for years, because we recognize that sarcoidal tissue reactions can also be seen in the background of a lymphoma. So one has to be very, very careful. You were able to make a diagnosis of cutaneous sarcoidosis on this and treat him. Cutaneous sarcoidosis can involve only photosensitive sites, what we refer to as a photosensitive or a photoaggravated sarcoidosis. It can also have a morphology of just very prominent blood vessels, what we refer to as the telangiectatic or the angiolupoid variants of sarcoidosis. It can involve just the subcutaneous fat without involvement of the dermis and what we refer to as the Dyer-Rowse variant of cutaneous sarcoidosis. So these are all multiple variants that we have encountered in our clinical practice, except this. I haven't yet seen lupus pernio in my clinical practice. It's a more mutilating, ulcerative form of cutaneous sarcoidosis, very often seen in the African subcontinent. It can cause septal and palatal perforations and more often associated with systemic involvement, but this we haven't encountered. This is the angiolupoid sarcoid, which actually is mistaken for a vascular malformation. Patients think that it's a capillary malformation, port wine stain, etc., and are looking for a cosmetic treatment, but it's actually a variant of sarcoidosis. You can have more than 90% body surface area involvement of the skin with sarcoidosis, what we refer to as the erythrodermic sarcoidosis. It can mimic a very common skin condition called lichen planus and therefore called lichenoid sarcoidosis. It can mimic psoriasis. These patients are inadvertently being treated for psoriasis for many, many years. And once we recognize that you can have this morphology for sarcoidosis, it can be picked up. There is an ulcerative variant. Again, patients being treated in rheumatology as infectious diseases, rheumatological ulcers. So chronic non-healing ulcer can also be a manifestation of sarcoidosis. It can just look like a wart or a seborrheic keratosis, what we refer to as a verrucous sarcoidosis. So many, many forms. It can look just like a scleroderma. It's a bound down skin mistaken for morphea or scleroderma, but it is actually a morpheiform form of sarcoidosis. And it may just be mistaken for a dry patch. Patients are applying emollients and moisturizer for years together without sarcoidosis having been picked up. And therefore, this entity of ichthyotic sarcoidosis also needs to be recognized. Now, this is a very cool sign that we've over the years picked up for a reasonable confidence in the diagnosis of sarcoidosis and exclusion from other erythematous, granulomatous diseases that you encounter. And as pulmonologists who also would be seeing skin cases could use this, which is the presence of this hypopigmented halo around the main lesion. So if you see a lesion which has a hypopigmented halo around it and it appears granulomatous, always think of sarcoidosis. So this is an important feature. It can manifest just with mucosal hyperplasia infiltration of the gingival mucosa, the tongue, the palate, the buccal mucosa, mistaken for Wegener, various causes, drug-induced hyperplasia or orofacial granulomatosis or a Wegener's granulomatosis, etc. There can be a genital, just sole manifestation of sarcoidosis can be a genital sarcoidosis, mistaken for a metastatic Crohn's disease. There can be a scarring alopecia as a manifestation of sarcoidosis. There can be mutilation of the nails, significant nail dystrophy in sarcoidosis. And when you take X-rays of such patients, and it has been mentioned by Saurav, that you would see the tuberculous multiplex cystica, where your tuberculus is a misnomer because it's because of sarcoidosis. Besides erythema nodosum, it has to be recognized that sarcoidosis can also lead to a medium vessel vasculitis. And a medium vessel vasculitis and erythema nodosum very often have a similar morphology. And therefore, biopsy helps us to differentiate between a septal paniculitis, which is an erythema nodosum, versus a granulomatous infiltrate around a small or a medium caliber vessel, which would be a medium vessel vasculitis. Now, this is a patient of sarcoidosis with systemic involvement who presented to us with calcinosis cutis. So because of persistent hypercalcemia and vitamin D, there can be calcinosis cutis. Now, as a dermatologist who also has interest in histomorphology and likes to look at slides under the microscope, we've also been able to, over the years, kind of appreciate certain patterns of cutaneous sarcoidosis seen under the microscope. So we all recognize, and the Pali will also be emphasizing on the classic morphology of this monomorphic, discrete, lymphocyte poor, reticulin rich reaction pattern being suggestive of a sarcoidal tissue reaction. And I'm just showing you this acid fast stain to basically appreciate the discreteness and the circumscription of the sarcoidal granulomas that is coming out beautifully. And in fact, one of the achievements that you could get out of a Zeal-Nielsen stain, even in the absence of an AFB negativity, is to appreciate the discreteness of these granulomas. But that's not the only finding in a sarcoidal tissue reaction. Though this morphology helps us to differentiate us from other causes of granulomatous pathologies, whether it be infectious or non-infectious, we don't have too much of a problem in differentiating cutaneous tuberculosis from cutaneous sarcoidosis, because cutaneous tuberculosis has a very well-established histomorphology of a lymphocyte-rich lichenoid granulomatous pattern. Deep fungal infection has a suppurative granulomatous pattern, which means it's a mixture of acute and chronic infiltrate. And leprosy has what we refer to as a leprosy pattern, which is a mixture of a superficial and a deep, a perivascular, periappendageal, and a perineural infiltrate of granulomas. But to us, for cutaneous sarcoidosis, histologically, PT leprosy is a great masquerader, and I'm going to talk to you about this in a little bit. So although in majority of our cases, the density of the lymphocytes is sparse, like in a characteristic sarcoidal granuloma, it has to be appreciated that you can get a moderate density of lymphocytes and sometimes even a rich amount of lymphocytic infiltrate in cutaneous sarcoidosis. So if you get a report saying lymphocyte-rich granuloma, don't completely disregard sarcoidosis, because that can happen. You can have your infiltrates being mild, moderate to very severe. You can have a confluent infiltrate. You can have an infiltrate only occurring in certain aspects of the dermis with sparing the rest of the dermis. You can have the infiltrate spilling into the subcutaneous fat and so on. So these are the various reaction patterns that can be seen. It can be a discrete, the classic discrete granuloma, or it can be a very confluent granuloma. But again, note that despite the confluence, the circumscription of each of these granulomas is still coming through, which helps us in making a diagnosis of sarcoidosis and excluding other granulomatous tissue reactions. You can have a vertical orientation, you can have a horizontal orientation, and you can have a combination of all these orientations. In our series, we found Langhans cells in 85%, foreign body giant cells in 62% of the cases. We can also see granulomas admixed with acute inflammation, plasma cells, lipidized macrophages, what we refer to as the foamy macrophages. So all this combination can occur in cutaneous sarcoidosis. Schwann bodies we found in about 4%, asteroid bodies in 23%, and we recognize that this is a non-specific feature that can be seen in granulomas of any cause. Fibrinoid necrosis is a very important reaction pattern in sarcoidosis, and this strongly helps in differentiating sarcoidosis from other granulomatous infiltrates. So if you see a small focus of fibrinoid necrosis, which is very, very conspicuous, we always think that this is cutaneous sarcoidosis. Fibrosis, which is more often seen in either tuberculosis or atypical mycobacterial infections, can also be seen in sarcoidosis. So if you get a report saying there is mild, moderate, or even severe fibrosis, don't think disregard sarcoidosis, because it can occur in sarcoidosis as much as it can occur in tuberculosis. This is an interesting morphology. Solitary cutaneous sarcoidosis are treated with intralesional corticosteroids, and this is a deposit of triamcinolone acetonide that was engulfed by the sarcoidal macrophages in this pattern. Now again, the traditional teaching is that the granulomas of sarcoidosis are all reticulin rich. Yes, about 46% in our series were reticulin rich, but we have to recognize that these granulomas can be of variable reticulin richness in sarcoidosis. So they can be absolutely reticulin poor, they can be predominantly reticulin rich, or they can be predominantly reticulin poor. So if you get a report says a granuloma that looks like sarcoidal, but it is reticulin poor, don't completely disregard sarcoidosis. I'll stop here. Thank you very much.
Good evening. I would like to thank Department of Pulmonary Medicine for this opportunity. So as the common saying goes that eye is a window to the body, so it's very much true for this disease. Whenever we see granulomatous inflammation in the eye, it tells us you have to go and look more within. And that's when we investigate more and maybe take the help most of our pulmonary colleagues that there is granulomatous inflammation in the eye. It might be there somewhere else in the body as well. And sarcoidosis comes high on the list for that. So what all is granulomatous inflammation in the eye? Most it can occur from the anterior aspect to the optic nerve and even the adnexa. So if we see this image, this is keratic precipitates, which are basically macrophages and monocytes, and they are deposited right behind the endothelium. So if you see clumps of these are granulomatous, and some of them are associated with high intraocular pressure. Usually inflammation is associated with low intraocular pressure. But if these two signs are present, then we suspect it could be one of the granulomatous diseases and sarcoidosis. If you go a little beyond that, this is a wide field photograph showing the retina and a little hazily because the vitreous in front is murky. It has the inflammatory cells floating there. So if there is a vitritis, we call it intermediate uveitis. There again, we have to suspect sarcoidosis. Importantly, it involves the medium vessels as well, as Dr. Sujoy pointed out. So we can see vasculitis in the eye, and mostly it is a venous involvement, and you see a lot of exudation along these vessels. So it could be idiopathic, which we call as Eales disease, but then sarcoidosis always will have to be ruled out in such cases. And as we already know, granulomas are in this disease common, so they can be present anywhere in the choroid, in the retina, in the optic disc. This is again a montage fundus image showing you a granuloma. So this patch here under the retinal vessels is again infiltration of the inflammatory cells in the choroid. So this is an investigation called OCT, where non-invasively using light, we can take a cut section through it. And the top part is the retinal layers and the bottom part is the choroidal layers. And here you can see the granuloma sitting right there. So this is the infiltration in the choroid. So you can diagnose non-invasively without a biopsy. It's a choroidal granuloma. First diagnosis becomes sarcoidosis, as opposed to tubercular granulomas, which we have seen, which are a little more aggressive. And the inflammation tends to spread rapidly from the choroid into the retina as well. But yes, differentiation can be a problem sometimes. So here you see again a whitish lesion there, but it's obscuring the retinal vessels. It's not in the choroid, it's in the superficial area. The OCT again tells you it's not in the choroid, it's in the retina. So this is a retinal granuloma. But again, yes, could be sarcoidosis. This patient we treated with steroids, and you see that the granuloma nicely just vanishes and you get a clean retina there. Fortunately, this granuloma was not involving the central aspect, so the patient's vision also recovers well. This is a rare manifestation which we have seen and published. An inflammatory manifestation causing neovascularization of the optic disc. So in a young patient, sudden neovascularization seen in the optic disc with evidence of inflammation in the eye, and patients were suspected to have sarcoidosis, and they had some other investigations, pulmonary investigations positive, and we treated them with again steroids. So other adnexal involvement can be in the form of lacrimal gland, orbital and conjunctival. I will not delve with too much of this. Primarily, I am a retina and uveitis specialist. But yes, in the adnexa, again, if you have granulomatous inflammation, then sarcoidosis goes high on your list. This is the perineal question. Is it TB or is it sarcoid? So the common investigations which everyone will go ahead for is a CCT chest. Look for the hilar lymphadenopathy. And we send a lot of patients for an endoscopic guided bronchial biopsy. Now, here there is a problem. Many ophthalmologists in our country, in a presence of granulomatous inflammation, without any other evidence, would start ATT if only a MON2 or an IGRA is positive. Now, this is something which we do not agree with. We do not agree, and we do not start just on the basis of a single MON2 and IGRA in our country and ATT. We would rather treat these patients with just steroids and immunosuppressants, and many of them do respond as well. But this is something which you can say there is about a 50% ophthalmologists would say it is TB and 50% would say no, it is something else. So this is something which we need to work on. And is there any role of PET CT? This I would probably like the house to answer, because now many people are getting this investigation done rather than the conventional CCT and the ultrasound abdomen. So for the ocular sarcoidosis, there was a committee which set up this diagnostic criteria. So as has been already said, that rule out other causes first and then go ahead for this. So some of the signs, photographs I've shown you, keratic precipitates, some snowballs in the vitreous, periphlebitis, granulomas, and generally they say it should be a bilateral disease, although you can have an asymmetrical presentation. So these are some signs which you have to look for and then get the standard investigations of a CT scan, ACE level, and a bronchoalveolar lavage findings. And based on a combination of this, they devise certain criteria that it is a definite sarcoidosis, ocular sarcoidosis, if it is proven by biopsy. It is a presumed ocular sarcoidosis if the biopsy does not prove it, but there is bilateral hilar lymphadenopathy with at least two of the intraocular signs which I just showed you. And if even if you don't have a hilar lymphadenopathy, if three signs are there and two systemic investigations are present, then also we may call it a probable ocular sarcoid. But again, this is not sufficient to diagnose all cases. And we have published a case where we had a disc granuloma with neovascularization, and we could not fit it into even a possible sarcoid, but then we did treat it like a sarcoid case only. We just called it a form first day of sarcoidosis. Management, till the manifestations are in the anterior segment, we treat it just by topical steroids. But once the inflammation has spread on to the back of the eye, intermediate or posterior uveitis, if it is unilateral, we give periocular steroids. Otherwise, oral steroids is the mainstay of treatment. And we would treat even if the pulmonologist at that stage doesn't want to treat. If they just say it's just simple, some hilar lymphadenopathy, and they would not want to give steroids. But if we are getting posterior uveitis, we would still start oral steroids for those patients. Presently, we are not starting primary immunosuppression for sarcoid patients. It is a second line therapy for those who become steroid dependent or recurrent cases. And now biologics also have a role in this disease. Thank you. Thank you very much.
So good evening, everyone. I'll be talking about the radiological features of sarcoidosis, predominantly of the thoracic involvement. So cardiac involvement, sir, has already shown some of the images of the MR with the involvement of the sub-epicardial regions. In thoracic sarcoidosis, the involvement can be both parenchymal, mediastinal, predominantly in the form of involvement of the lymph nodes in the mediastinum, tracheobronchial involvement, as well as the pleural involvement. Now, the several radiological features are categorized as typical features and atypical features. Imaging modality-wise, the chest radiography remains the first investigations, and also the staging, which was initially put up for sarcoidosis, the SILBAS staging, is based on chest X-ray. On CT, it is useful for diagnosis, staging of the disease, extent evaluation, follow-ups, as well as to rule out other alternative or other treatable causes for activity assessment, as well as for the detection of some complications. MR predominantly has a role nowadays for these patients are on very long-term follow-ups, and in the involvement of lymph nodes and as well as the lung involvement, we can use MR as a modality for the serial follow-up of these patients, and PET CT again for the activity assessment and also to look for a very suitable site for a biopsy. These are the classical chest X-ray. Several signs are described for this feature, that there is, if you see a predominant involvement by the nodes of the regions like right paratracheal region, along with very symmetric type of involvement of bilateral hilar nodes, this is called a sarcoidosis 1, 2, 3 sign or a garland sign. In this chest radiograph, you can see that there is involvement of the nodes. Apart from that, if you see reticular nodular opacities in both the bilateral upper lobes, in stage 1, you only get lymphadenopathy. The key is to understand that the involvement of the lymph nodes is usually symmetric and in this classical distribution pattern. The lung parenchyma involvement is predominantly seen in the upper and the mid zones, with the predominant feature being a reticular nodular pattern. It may be asymmetric. More or less, the symmetry is again a feature which gives us radiologically to distinguish between sarcoid and tuberculosis at times. And fissural nodularity, these types of fissural thickening may also be identified on a chest X-ray. In stage 3, there is predominant involvement only of the lung parenchyma, and in stage 4, it has already reached into the fibrotic state. On CT, it is important to look for other atypical in cases where there are atypical clinical findings and to detect complications, extent evaluation. CT is most sensitive for picking up subtle parenchymal abnormalities, that is the presence of typical lung parenchymal perilymphatic distribution nodules. On the lymphadenopathy pattern, again on CT, follows the same as we saw on a chest X-ray. The involvement of the right peritracheal location and the bilateral hilar location and the subcarinal locations. These are very classically seen in sarcoidosis. Again, the morphology-wise, the nodes tend to be more of homogeneous attenuation, show homogeneous enhancement, no peripheral or rim kind of enhancement. And the presence of central necrosis is one of the features which again helps us to distinguish between tuberculosis and sarcoidosis. Some lymph nodes in some of the sarcoidosis cases also, we have seen that the node may be very low in attenuation as well on a contrast scan. Sometimes that is confused with a tubercular pattern. One important feature is that these lymph nodes, the location of the nodes, you can see that we are way beyond the hilum, we are into the lung parenchyma. These are the bronchopulmonary group of the nodes. The similar character being homogeneous and discrete lymph nodes. So presence of these site lymph nodes again are seen in more likely in sarcoidosis over tuberculosis. Some other features like cluster of black pearl sign and all have been also shown in one study only till now. Atypical features of the lymphadenopathy would be presence of only unilateral involvement. Again, as I shown, this bronchopulmonary stations, presence of calcifications, and several patterns of calcifications are described in sarcoidosis. Sometimes the peripheral rim type of calcification, which also is seen in silicosis, similar. And this type of pattern is called as the icing sugar pattern, which is very hazy type of a calcification within the center of the node. Presence of internal mammary group of nodes, paraesophageal lymph nodes, these are other typical sites. In the lung parenchymal changes, this is a classical imaging pattern, where we can see that there are multiple perilymphatic nodules, which are coursing along the peribronchovascular interstitium, along the fissures, and along the subpleural interstitium. So this type of distribution of discrete micronodules is classically seen as a predominant pattern in sarcoidosis. Apart from the nodules, you can see there may be presence of such conglomerated consolidation masses, which are predominantly localized along the perihilar or peribronchovascular location towards more towards the center of the lungs. These again tend to be bilaterals and symmetric involvement. However, such in, like in the lower image, you can see that there may be an asymmetric involvement by these types of conglomerated masses. Now in this pattern, apart from the lymph nodes, the lung parenchyma shows multiple tiny nodules, which are distributed almost entirely along the whole of the lung parenchyma. This pattern is a miliary pattern, which may also be seen in sarcoidosis. Another, some very characteristic features, you can say, of the clusters of the nodules. So this is termed as a cluster sign, which is described. These are multifocal patches of this cluster of the nodules, which we may see in these cases of sarcoidosis. And you can see again this another case which depicts the presence of these clusters of nodules in several regions of the lung. Again, following the pattern that they tend to be clustered along the peribronchovascular interstitium. So these are called cluster sign, galaxy sign, fairy ring sign, several names are given for it. The pleural involvement, as sir had also shown you in the starting, that they are typically seen but may be seen in some of the cases, and it's a biopsy diagnosis most of the times. And imaging wise, the pleural involvement, once we get, we tend to first keep a probability of a tuberculosis. But pleural involvement in sarcoidosis can present with effusion, pleural thickening, and the presence of pleural lymphadenopathy. Coming on to some of the advantages of MR, MR is predominantly used in these group of patients as a part of the follow-up protocol to look for the size and character change of the lymph nodes. The lung parenchymal changes may also be followed up serially because it being a radiation-free modality, and you can use it for the same. So I would, these are the other system involvement images like These are the salivary glands. This is the parotid gland involvement. You can see multiple tiny cysts formation can happen in the salivary glands. PNS involvement presents with the thickening of the mucoperiosteal thickening. In the cardiac involvement, you can see that there is a sub-epicardial late gadolinium enhancement. And in the neurosarcoidosis, there is a patchy meningeal enhancement or the nodular type of the leptomeningeal enhancement. That's the commonest pattern of the neurosarcoidosis. So radiological diagnosis is mostly based on these nodal and the perilymphatic distribution of the lung abnormalities. And atypical manifestations, when they come, they make the diagnosis challenging. However, there are several overlapping features also with tuberculosis. And imaging, again, plays an important role in diagnosis, activity, and follow-up. Thank you. Yes, sir.
Sarcoidosis is talked about all the time. We recognize that fibrinoid necrosis within the lymph nodes can also occur in patients with sarcoidosis. And we've seen patients with axillary lymphadenopathy, which were seen on CT, and they had fibrinoid necrosis on histopathology, characteristic sarcoidal reactions. But radiologically, because they showed necrosis, a diagnosis of tuberculosis
is usually made.
So are you able to, on imaging, differentiate between the various types of necrosis? Because if you are not, then necrosis may not be a good way to rule out sarcoidosis or put tuberculosis high on the list.
So because radiologically, different types of necrosis is not distinguishable.
Right.
But if necrosis is there, that is, there are several signals on MR and CT and presence of, if we give contrast and we see the rim enhancement pattern with the center being totally non-enhancing, that term is labeled as a necrosis. Sometimes sarcoid node itself gives us a very low attenuation on CT. It is not representation of a true necrosis within the lymph node. It may be a character of the node itself which gives us very low signals sometimes.
So is
we
this
cannot distinguish like several types of necrosis.
So, sir, I think this is a very important thing. I think it's good that many specialties are here together, because I think we'll also discuss on the clinical part that we find necrotizing granulomas in a fair proportion of our patients. So I think whether in TB endemic settings, there is something which we need to find out further is actually required. So I'll briefly summarize through tissue. So you understand there is so much confusion regarding the radiology. You need a histopathological diagnosis to conclusively, you know, demonstrate the presence of a non-necrotizing granulomatous inflammation, even necrotizing granulomatous inflammation in a compatible profile. That is why the final diagnosis is an integration of the clinical, pathological, and radiological findings. So that is what you need to do. If you have an accessible site, a lymph node like a conjunctival nodule, a lacrimal tissue, something which you can pick up, or a skin, that is easy. But most of the time, it is not. So I think for us, most of the time, it's an intrathoracic involvement. And I even think, even for the cardiac and the hepatosplenic population, an intrapulmonary sampling is important. I'd like to bring your attention to the recent recommendations from the ATS, American Thoracic Society, on diagnosis of sarcoid. And they've put in a very controversial statement, I think. They've said that lymph node biopsy may be avoided in patients with a typical presentation of sarcoid. I think that is not entirely true in a high TB prevalence settings. And I think with the data which we can generate from mediastinal TB and sarcoid, we may be able to demonstrate that they look quite similar, but you need a biopsy. So the 10% of patients may be tuberculin positive. Serum ACE has a poor sensitivity specificity, and I think hypercalcemia is in a low proportion of patients. So I think these clinical and investigation patterns in isolation are not very useful. Regarding intrathoracic sampling, you have these three modalities. You can either sample the lymph node, you can sample the lung, or you can take a bronchoalveolar lavage fluid. Bronchoalveolar lavage fluid has a very variable sensitivity and specificity, and in Indian settings and in high prevalence settings of TB, it has not been studied. So this is what it looks like. You have, you know, a needle which is puncturing through the bronchoscope blindly. It's called a blind TBNA in the subcranial lymph node. And now what we use is endosonography, thereby meaning we have a dedicated bronchoscope with an ultrasound at its tip, which through the bronchus gives us a real-time visualization of the mediastinal lymph nodes through which we can do needle sampling. You can put our ultrasound bronchoscope through the esophagus, which is called as USBFNA. So the same bronchoscope can be used to sample the central lymph nodes. And the third thing is you can refer to the gastroenterologist for a US FNA. So lung biopsy modalities mean you can take a pinch biopsy of the mucosa, or you can go peripherally and take a biopsy of the alveolar sample. These are called as the endobronchial and transbronchial biopsies, and before the endosonography era, and even today, they are very important in the diagnostic armamentarium of sarcoidosis. So what do? So evidence supports that once you go inside with a bronchoscope, you try to do a lymph node sampling along with the bronchial, mucosal and a lung sampling. So if you combine the node sampling with endobronchial and transbronchial biopsy, your yield is likely going to be higher. Sometimes when we do a lymph node aspiration, we can have the assistance of pathology, something called as a ROSE or a rapid on-site evaluation. Though we don't have good data, but I think if you have a rapid on-site cytology showing non-necrotizing granulomas, you can probably avoid a lung biopsy and reduce the risk. But I think this needs more data to support this. So what we see that how EBUS has changed practice, because the most common indication of EBUS in our country is not lung cancer, it is TB and sarcoid. In fact, sarcoidosis is the most common indication for EBUS TB in our country. So I think this is an important modality, and half of the centers are performing rapid on-site evaluation, and nearly 3/4 of the respondents are routinely performing lung biopsy along with the endobronchial ultrasound biopsy. So this is my concluding slide. What is the yield of these modalities? So in our cohort, we found that EBUS TBNA or just a needle aspiration had a yield of close to 70 to 80%, and the yield of the lung biopsy and the mucosal biopsy were 50 to around 33%. Important is if you add these modalities, your combined yield may exceed 90% or more. But this is what Dr. Sujay was also referring. We had necrotizing granulomas in 13.5% of our patients who were treated as sarcoid. And I think this is something, this data has to come from high TB settings. Otherwise, this diagnosis of sarcoid based on non-necrotizing granulomas would actually stay. I think we need to clarify. So I think I'd like to invite Dr. Dipali for the pathology aspects.
So this is the last slide. Concluding ones. So Dr. Sujoy has already done my half of the job. So specimens we receive in Department of Pathology for sarcoidosis are cytology and surgical pathology specimens. In cytology, BAL for differential leukocyte count, because sarcoidosis patients tend to show lymphocyte predominance, and EBUS TBNA from enlarged lymph nodes. And they're most often coupled with the surgical pathology specimens like endobronch biopsy, TBLBs, and core clot biopsies, which are the clots which are present in the core of the EBUS needle. And we make cell blocks from these aspirates. Surgical lung biopsy, which is video-assisted thoracoscopic surgical lung biopsy, which is an option, but this is not commonly done. It's a rare option. And then, as we have discussed, lymph node biopsy or any site where lesions are present, such as skin or ocular lesions, these biopsies are received. This is one such EBUS TBNA smear from the mediastinal lymph node, which is adequate and diagnostic. These are the granulomas which are seen in the background of reactive lymphoid tissue. This is higher magnification to show well-formed discrete non-necrotizing granulomas, reactive lymphoid tissue in the background. This is GIMSA stained cytology smear. This is higher magnification of one such epithelioid cell granuloma. There is no giant cell in this photograph. This is one of the carbon-laden macrophage, which is coming from the draining hilar lymph nodes. This is a cell block from the EBUS TBNA, shows discrete non-necrotizing again granulomas, crushed lymphoid tissue, which is actually, this is from the lymph nodes, so some lymphoid tissue is there in the background. Otherwise, not much inflammation. And this is the corresponding cytology smear. So in a well-established case of sarcoidosis on histology, what we see, as has already been described, these are the discrete naked granulomas because they don't have much inflammation around them. But the peculiar thing is hyalinization and fibrosis around these granulomas. So that is what is a very peculiar quality of sarcoid granulomas. And in surgical lung biopsy, we tend to see the pattern, which is nodular pattern, in which these granulomas have subpleural and septal location. They course through the distribution of lymphatics and venules. And relatively
uninvolved lung parenchyma, which is again a characteristic feature to diagnose sarcoid, because this intergranulomatous lung parenchyma is relatively uninvolved, healthy, and non-inflamed. Unlike other granulomatous diseases, for example, tuberculosis, we see some amount of inflammation and unhealthy lung parenchyma in comparison to sarcoid. So 3S related to sarcoid is subpleural, septal, and sarcoid. That's how we remember these sarcoid granulomas and the peculiar fibrosis or hyalinization, which we don't see in classical cases of tuberculosis. And these pictures have already been shown. These are the inclusions, but they are not specific for sarcoid. We can see in tuberculosis, we can see in HP and other granulomatous diseases. This is yet another case where the discrete granuloma is present, some amount of inflammation. This is lymphoid tissue of the native lymph node. Again, some Langhans type of giant cells, granulomas, but on AFB, there were tons of acid fast bacilli. So meaning to say that they can look alike. So you cannot just based on morphology, you cannot make diagnosis of sarcoidosis. And in our country, it is very essential to exclude tuberculosis first and foremost. So confirm as pathologists, our job is to confirm the presence of granulomas, appreciate the distinctive features of granulomas. They are naked, they are confluent, they are discrete, but they can coalesce and they can show confluence. Lymphangitic distribution on CT. And the most important thing is to exclude the infection by cultures or by special stains. And ultimately, it's a clinical pathologic diagnosis. Thank you. I would request Dr. Galeria to.
Already crossed time, so I'll be very quick. Treatment of sarcoidosis is basically the first question is to treat or not to treat. I think that becomes a very important issue because many patients who have sarcoidosis are asymptomatic. Many of them you will have who come for a routine checkup or for a medical checkup and bilateral hyalur adenopathy is picked up. It's a self-remitting disease, and for a large number of individuals, no treatment is actually required or just symptomatic treatment is required. So issues with treatment is there's heterogeneity, as we've seen, multiple specialties are involved. It can be just limited cutaneous manifestation, or it could be ocular manifestation where just topical steroids are required rather than systemic steroids. There's a different natural history of the disease in different subsets of patients. And there are different modalities of treatment. Of course, all treatment also have side effects. So I think the basic principle of treatment are basically just two. If there is severe organ dysfunction, you have to treat sarcoid. If that is not there, you would give localized treatment rather than giving systemic treatment. Or if you want to improve quality of life and significant symptoms dominate presentation, you may consider treatment. So basically what you try to do is you try and see a balance. If the person is symptomatic, organ function impairment is there, is organ endangerment, progressive disease, clear-cut activity, low likelihood of admission, treatment is favored. But on the other hand, if there's minimal symptoms, good organ function, low risk of danger, inactive disease, you may just observe or give symptomatic treatment. Steroids are the initial mainstay of treatment. Low dose is preferred and it's given in pulmonary sarcoid if there's major morbidity from pulmonary sarcoids, high risk of future mortality or permanent disability, or you believe that it may improve or preserve the lung function or the quality of life, and some people even use the 6-minute walk test to take a call on this. Subsequently, if the person is not responding to steroids or he's symptomatic with the higher risk of future mortality or permanent disability from sarcoid, and who has been treated with glucocorticoids and continues to be symptomatic or has unaccepted side effects from steroids, methotrexate is the second drug of choice that has been shown or is recommended. When do you use it? When there's disease progression despite adequate steroids, inability to taper off your glucocorticoids below 10 milligrams of prednisolone, disease relapse, patient has side effects of steroids, or the patient is not willing to take steroids. Other drugs have been used, azathioprine, mycophenolate, mofetil, leflunomide, hydroxychloroquine, and even biologicals have been used. So these are the drugs which have been used. And if you look at what the dose, low dose steroids is usually preferred. As a matter of fact, the recommendation is as low as 20 milligram of prednisolone daily. You may consider a higher dose for cardiac or neurosarcoid, going up to still 0.5 or 0.75 milligram per kg. One doesn't really give a very high dose. You can use methotrexate, leflunomide, MMF, and then you can use biologicals also. And in some patients, hydroxychloroquine has been used, especially as far as cutaneous involvement is concerned. What about head-to-head data? Some studies have looked at methotrexate versus azathioprine, really shown no difference, but there was more infection in the azathioprine group. Similarly, leflunomide has also been used. Again, not much data to suggest that one is superior over the other. and even infliximab has been used in a dose of 5 milligram per kg, showed a very insignificant improvement in the vital capacity. I don't think that is clinically significant. A lot of new drugs are also being looked at. The JAK inhibitors, there are multiple trials on that. Various biologicals are also being looked at, and therefore one is looking at more specific treatment, both from the point of pulmonary sarcoid and from the point of view of cardiac sarcoid. The latest ERS guidelines actually really says that if you have pulmonary sarcoid, you assess for need for treatment. If there is low risk, you just observe. And if there is a need, then later on you may consider steroids. So just observation is required. If there's a high risk, steroids are usually preferred. And if there is an intermediate risk, but there is impairment in quality of life, you may also consider steroid and then look for the response. If the response is not good enough or there is significant side effects, you can go on to methotrexate. Again, look for the response and whether you can successfully taper off the glucocorticoids. If that does not happen, then you can go on to infliximab, and later on you can even go on to rituximab. So in a simplified version, what it really says is start with steroids 20 milligram per day, unsuccessful glucocorticoid tapering, or there are side effects, methotrexate would be the drug of choice, but others could be used. If still you're not able to decrease the steroids or there is high chance of relapse, infliximab can be used, and subsequently you could consider rituximab. What is really not clear is the duration of treatment. Most studies would say that at least 6 months to 1 year treatment should be given. There are some studies who suggest that if you stop steroids early, there's a higher chance of relapse. So one would tend to give treatment for about 9 months to 1 year. Low dose, you would start steroids, taper it off over 6 weeks, say about 4 to 6 weeks, and you may continue low dose maintenance steroids for up to 9 months. But there is really no data in terms of what is the exact duration. People argue that in cardiac sarcoid and neurosarcoid, you may continue treatment even for a longer period of time because of the fear that this may relapse chances of it may cause significant morbidity as far as that is concerned. Efficacy of one second line drug over the other is again not clear. And should long-term steroids be given in patients with high risk of relapse or refractory disease, again is not clear. Should you then continue methotrexate for a longer period of time? And should we have a similar approach when there is different organ involvement? For example, the ophthalmologist would actually prefer more of topical steroids rather than systemic steroids if they could. And similar could be for cutaneous involvement. Cardiologists may prefer, along with the ICD, to give steroids for a longer period of time. And some of the guidelines, if you look at it from organ point of view, especially the Japanese guidelines, sometimes even recommend lifelong treatment with immunosuppressive treatment in patients with cardiac sarcoid because of the high mortality and morbidity that they see. So I'll stop here and we can have a few minutes for questions. We've already crossed our time, but if there are any questions, then I'll ask Dr. Nandamohan Karan and all the others to come in front, and the topic is open for discussion or questions.
And so should you give steroids? I mean, because you know it got fluid retention and it may worsen the heart failure. They're not, so any role for biomarkers, inflammatory biomarkers that can drive the decision to start steroids or not? I mean, there's some data now coming from the PET studies where if there is inflammation, you start steroids repeated at 3 months, if it goes down, or any other biomarkers that we could use. I mean, that's currently a very difficult clinical.
Currently, none of the biomarkers is specific enough. We did a study long time back where we looked at PET, and we looked at PET in patients with sarcoid and repeated a PET after about 6 to 9 months. Interestingly, when we did a PET scan in all our sarcoid patients, we found a lot of uptake in various organs, including the liver, spleen, even in inguinal nodes, which we had not picked up. In about 2/3 of these patients after 9 months, I think it was 2/3, the PET had totally shown a resolution. But there were some patients, so we divided them into three groups: complete remission, partial remission, and progression of disease. So majority of patients had complete remission. There were some in whom the PET still showed uptake, but it was less than before. But in others, you had new uptake happening. So PET may be useful. The only problem is the radiation exposure that happened. And sometimes these patients are young, you don't want to do it. But PET as a marker of disease activity could be useful. Other markers are not really specific enough, and that's why you'll have to go by the clinical radiological profile of the patient to take a call on whether to continue. So my own feeling is that you have to individualize your treatment strategy over a period of time, and sometimes it's basically seeing how the patient is. I don't know if any comments from
biomarker. I think still in practice we don't have anything. I think areas of future research are going on, and I'm sure one of that would be to evaluation of various things in the exhaled breath. Now with some people here who are doing it, but that's a long way off from clinical use as of now. I would say still a research tool. We are trying to look at differentiation between TB and sarcoid non-invasively through exhaled breath, various biomarkers, but not for clinical practice right now. No, we don't really have much.
Any predictive factors which can say that this patient can go in fibrosis of the lung parenchyma will happen or not? Sometimes we see the entire parenchymal changes, they resolve. But sometimes we are not able to predict that one of the patient may go into a fibrosis more than the other patient.
So I don't. People had used initially Skadding's criteria only to say that if you had stage 3 disease, chances are higher that you would go on to fibrotic sarcoid. Currently, I'm not sure that we have any marker which is can predict how sarcoidosis will progress in terms of the disease.
Even your Skadding criteria, I think recently they are saying it's not a marker of severity actually even. So it's not a reliable marker of severity. So probably even your ACE levels are not a reliable marker of severity. So we don't have a predictive tool.
You cannot really predict upfront how a patient would behave in terms of progression of disease. And one thing I have not mentioned because there's not much data on it, is there a role of antifibrotics in fibrotic sarcoid? The inbuilt study had a few patients who were fibrotic sarcoid and who were treated with nintedanib as part of that study, but the number was too small. So when we talk of fibrosis, is there a role of giving antifibrotics in sarcoid? Again, I don't think we have enough data right now to say one way or the
other. My only suggestion is since we all are here, we should have a common case record form which we can share through a red cap and
I think that is important, and maybe as we were talking to have a biobank so that and we can look at some markers which may come out later on and you have a sample that is there. As far as I remember, one thesis that was done by Swapnil that showed about 10% of patients in that thesis who were not having any symptoms when were evaluated, he excluded all patients who had symptoms in terms of palpitation, were diagnosed to have cardiac sarcoid even when they were asymptomatic. That was a study done, I think, about 5-6 years ago.
I think that's a good idea, but to have a common pro forma.
11 out of 100, yeah, so 10%.
So I think that's very important. What we've realized is sarcoid is behaving quite different from what is reported in the Western literature. Whether it's true for extra pulmonary also, and as Dr. Surya also brought, whether you see a fair bit of necrotizing, you know, granulomatous in your skin samples, I don't know. So, I mean, a profile data, which we have a large profile data, and along with the histopathological and radiological data, may actually give a very different picture of mediastinal TB and sarcoid in our country. I think we should do that.
And I think the challenge will remain TB versus sarcoid, and how do we do that? Because that is something which has to be done only in countries like India. It cannot be done in the Western world. They don't have tuberculosis. Sarcoidosis and tuberculosis, we will have to develop a strategy of how do we differentiate between the two. I don't think we've reached it, but we will need to do that because it's something which will have to come from countries like India.
Something will have to come out of country to differentiate sarcoid versus TB. I think ultimately.
I have not seen pulmonary tuberculosis histopathology.
That's what I'm saying.
Therefore, things become very easy for me.
They see both TB and sarcoid, so somehow they'll have to kind of.
So, in the West, you won't have TB. So, when they see a picture like this, they make a diagnosis of sarcoid, and that's why this is that argument that we've had in one of our meetings where one of the pulmonologists from the US showed an X-ray and said, if I see this X-ray, I will not even do anything and I'll just straight away make a diagnosis of sarcoid. The argument that we had was that this in our country will not work. if you have bilateral hilar adenopathy, you cannot straight away say that this is sarcoid. And he said, you don't need to do a bronchoscopy, you don't need a tissue sample, you can just make a diagnosis of sarcoid. That is not correct in our country. You can still have tuberculosis. You may say the symmetrical nodes are very suggestive of sarcoid, but I don't think it's enough to say that this is definitely sarcoid and you've ruled out tuberculosis. I personally feel we will have to develop some biomarkers or a combination of biomarkers which will help to differentiate TB from sarcoid. There have been a lot of people, I know a number of PhD theses done here and in PGI, but currently we haven't really come out with anything with a high sensitivity and specificity.
As far as skin is concerned, we have a dilemma, like you have dilemma between tuberculosis and sarcoidosis. We have a dilemma between leprosy and sarcoidosis. And the reason is twofold. A lot of our leprosy shows, a lot of our sarcoidosis shows granulomas in a very leprosy pattern. And you very often see perineural granulomas. So perineural granuloma is not a prerogative of just leprosy. It can occur in sarcoidosis. So when, perineural granulomas are seen, they think that it's leprosy, but it isn't.
How commonly you see leprosy otherwise?
Very common. We run a leprosy clinic. Yeah, it's not eliminated at all.
Few cases, yeah.
Leprosy is not eliminated at all. Probably research in leprosy that has got eliminated.
So if your gene expert is positive, then it's a gold standard. Negative is a problem because if you're taking a sample, it's a limited sample. You may still miss. You may not have a high bacillary load. Tubercular lymphadenitis is a posse bacillary disease. It may still be missed. The other important thing is to remember that you may have a MON2 negative because sarcoid causes cutaneous energy. So there is well documented, and you'll have patients who had sarcoid, the MON2 was negative. You treated the sarcoid, they became all right, MON2 became positive. So you will have cutaneous energy, but IGRA will be positive. So in sarcoid, you have cutaneous energy, but I think the paper by Dr. Dheeraj Gupta from PGI also showed that you may have IGRA positive in a significant number of patients of sarcoid, but MON2 is negative because of cutaneous energy that sarcoid causes. Okay, thank you very much, and thank you for staying for more than the time that we had.